thank you all for coming. So today's panel is Plays Well With Others, Consent and Interactive Media. We'll be talking about the role of consent in interactive media, mainly games, because it seems contextually appropriate. The role of consent and the responsibilities of consent in the creator-viewer relationship. I'm your moderator, Jenna Ray, aka Double Cakes. I'm a pinball journalist and wrestler.
Just tying that on. And wrestler.
It's when your co-panelists laugh at you at your intro, that's why I'm the moderator, not one of the panelists. So let's go down, everyone introduce themselves, and then we'll start the meat and potatoes of it.
Hi, I'm Maddie Bryce. I'm a games critic and developer. I also do activism around games diversity and inclusion, and also some more kind of new design type things. And I do lots of organizing with events and community functions and doing all sorts of things. So yeah, that's a little bit about me.
I'm Kitty Stryker. I am the head of cosplay here, and I also run a website called consentculture.com, which is seeking to reconsider how we talk about rape culture and how we talk about entitlement, and what sort of things we can model instead of those things. So,
hey, I'm Merritt, AKA Merritt. I make games about like hugging people and hitting people, except the games where you hit people, they want you to hit them, so it's like kind of different from usual video games. yeah.
Thank you. Thank all of you. So I guess first we should start with, I think we should start with like a small extrapolation of like the nuance of consent, because I feel like a lot of people, especially in mainstream heteronormative culture, we have this idea of consent, which is, yes is yes, or the absence of a no is yes. And consent actually covers a much wider spectrum of power dynamics and boundaries and human interactions. So I think that it'd be good if we all, for a brief moment, expand upon what consent means to us and where we feel that cultural definitions, collective cultural definitions of consent are lacking, especially within our chosen field.
So I guess for me, I feel like Kitty, you should start this since you like write about
Great.
It so often.
Awesome, yeah. I do talk about this like all the time. So for me, I have a constantly evolving definition of consent. And I feel like it's difficult to talk about consent without also talking about coercion and talking about systems of power. Because I think that the idea that not just that yes means hold on. Sorry, I haven't had enough coffee yet. I think that there's this belief that yes is a definite term of consent that ignores things like coercion or self-imposed pressure to say yes. I think, obviously that is influenced a lot by feminist writers that I think about and talk about. But I feel that there's sort of systems of power in place that can influence our feeling of agency and our ability to say no. So I feel like, I guess I would say consent to me means that your no will be accepted without question and without guilt.
Mm-hmm. I would also like to add on to that. For me, consent is also a complete upheaval of how we have intimacy right now in normative culture. I think, like, so right now I'm kind of, you know, I'm single and I'm going through OkCupid, which is horrible. But I know. And the horrible thing with, like, dates and even with partners are people who are like, how about we just get together and see what happens? And I'm like, no, I don't want that to happen, because I think that's the normative thing. Like, if we see in movies, when we see passion and intimacy, we just see people kind of just run into each other and, you know, fall over in, hopefully into bed and, you know, pan shots and things like that. And I don't really think that actually happens as often as we'd like in reality. And especially when you might have differing ideas of gender and sexuality. So for me, the majority of my partners are cisgender and I'm not, and I don't really trust a lot of cisgender people to know how to approach someone who isn't. And so I think consent is this restructuring of, like, we both have a very clear idea of exactly what we both want before we engage in this, and we are gonna do exactly what we want to do. And it's kind of like this, it restabilizes things. It says, what is actually what we want is to make sure that we please our other partner with full knowledge of what that is, instead of, you know, placing, let's say, in normative relationships, like, the dominant partner must intuitively know exactly what this, you know, submissive partner wants and does it whether they might not seem, you know, all on board. So that's kind of like my contribution to that.
So yeah, I think Kitty and Maddie did, like, a super good job of talking about, like, the general, like, scope of consent. So I'm not gonna, like, just say the same things that they said, because they did, like, an amazing job. But to, like, bring it to games specifically, which is, like, what I do. I think for me, like, the big thing is thinking about consent as, like, not, like, moving past, like, what folks have been saying about, like, this discrete, like, yes, no kind of thing, and, like, moving towards thinking about a context of care or trust, like, thinking about the context that consent happens in, right? So when I think about games, I think about, like, this trend over the last, like, 2 to 3 years of games that place the player in a situation in which they're supposed to do something that in the narrative of the game is, like, reprehensible, right? So, like, how many people played Spec Ops? I think it's, like, past the, like, statute of limitations for spoilers, right? So, like, in Spec Ops, like, there's a certain point in the game where it's, like, you have to do this horrible thing to progress, and this isn't unique to that game, but, like, so your choices are, okay, well, I can do this thing, or I can just, like, turn the game off, and, like, if you do it, it's like, wow, you're such a horrible person. I can't believe you just did that, what I, the developer, wanted you to do. Right. And it's, like, no, like, that doesn't prove anything about people being terrible. It proves that they're playing a video game, and that they know they are, and that they're following the rules that the developer told them to. And, like, there isn't, like, a trust there. There's, like when I think about consent and, like, about kink play and stuff, like, I think that, you know, when there is good consent, like, a scene should be about, like, growth and, like, trust. And in those kinds of situations in games, like, that's totally absent. It's about, like, mocking the player. And there isn't that context of, like, care or trust or empathy at all. So that's something I think about a lot with regards to consent in games.
It's it's interesting, Merit, that you had mentioned, like, the, like, that, like, setting up the reprehensible action. I remember when I first started playing Dungeons and Dragons, the Dungeon Master's Manual from, like, second edition, like, specifically has, like, a false scenario, like a mock scenario for you to, like, play your characters through so that you can, like, learn what it's like to be a dungeon master. And part of that means, like, forcing the players to, like, walk into traps and forcing them to be, like, imprisoned by monsters. And then at the end, it's like, you know, and it wasn't really fair for you to do that, but it was important for you to, like, learn how to, like, fuck up and, like, be, like, a not fair player so you could then be scolded for it. Like, that goes, like, that's sort of, like, almost, like, intrinsic, and I feel like that's been intrinsic in, like, games designed by, like, white cisgender men, like, all the way back to, like, fucking tabletop. I also want to add on before I push forward that, like, my personal grasp of consent, I feel like I feel like the BDSM industrial complex has done a really good job of propagating this idea that like tops and doms cannot have their consent violated because this is part of where I come from as far as consent. Like for me, like consent is all about non-negotiable power differences or power differences, you know. So like, yes, a grad student who is TAing a class can have sex with a student, and they might be the same age, but there is non-negotiable power difference, and that I feel like to a degree negates that consent, and so.
Can I say something on that?
Yeah.
That's actually an area that I'm particularly interested in because I feel that. For the work I do with consent culture, my belief is that it's impossible to get 100% consent in a capitalistic patriarchy. I just don't think it's possible. I think that there are systems of oppression in place that influence us and influence our decisions. So what if we give up this idea that consent is 100%, that yes is 100%, and start to acknowledge that maybe the best we can do is like 95%, and maybe it's 90%, maybe it's less. How then do we deal with it when things go wrong and we're accountable to that? And we have to acknowledge our accountability. And I think that that's an area that doesn't get talked about. We talk a lot about how it feels to be a survivor or to be victimized or things like that. But and we even are starting to talk a little bit about the abuser side of things, but we don't really talk about microaggressions and how these interactions happen all the time. They're pretty constant. I've noticed that when I've been to gay male orgies, for example, that a lot of the times the way I watch people interact is they'll actually block each other's access to like leave the conversation, and they won't even notice that they're doing it. This is totally subconscious. It's just, you know, the crowd is pushing them around, but that generally means that like even if the person doesn't feel like alienated or creeped out, there is that sense of just that physical embodiment of not being able to leave the conversation. Like you have to stay there. And I think it's really important to learn how to assert boundaries around that stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, you know, what you're describing actually reminds me of a lot of things I talk about when I do consulting on safe spaces and the idea of like, you know, there's no such thing as a 100% safe space. Like a safe space is a work in progress that that everyone is striving for. In a community, and it sounds like that's the same thing in where we understand that things that we do can trigger something that neither parties were aware of or things like that, and to know how to deal with those problems and how to respond is kind of one of the things I find isn't really talked about in safe space creation as well, of like, well, what do you do when, you know, many people who are on different pages of social justice and awareness and things are in the same space, and how do they solve those interpersonal issues? That's a super important, you know, aspect to maintaining these sort of spaces. So it sounds like that maybe be a dual kind of thing of, you know, I think the dominant discourse puts things into perpetrators and victims, and like that's the only things that we seem to be able to cast people as in these situations, besides the fact that we're all human and we need to figure out how to actually do things when, you know, stuff come up. So yeah,
you're both really good. Do you have anything to add, Merritt?
No. Wait, no pressure.
No, I'm just, I should be in the audience, I feel like.
No, you're fine.
I do want to maybe as like a stepping stone to other topics of conversation is that I feel that the current conversations we're having about consent really are disadvantaged by this black and white idea of like perpetrators and victims. And this also ties in hand to hand with like topic that's really relevant lately, and this idea that that like overstepping somebody's consent is this like unforgivable, egregious sin, and that the only way to like heal as a community or to move forward is to like exile and banish every single person who has ever overstepped consent, and like
everyone,
not only is that everyone, because like so many like power differences are not negotiable, but also like I also feel to a degree that that feeds this that feeds these narratives that we have like in games or in media, where like, oh well, if I want to make the character really bad, if I want to make them like, I just got to make them rape somebody, I have to make them like force themselves onto somebody, like.
Or if you want to make a character sympathetic.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think what's really interesting, and I think you know, American. Attribute to this as well is there's a large conversation about agency in games. Like one of the things that you know, mainstream games love to say is like, you have a whole bunch of agency, you can do whatever you want, and so because of that you get really particular, you know, themes of power very often, and who gets their agency taken away is very, you know, slanted in certain ways, and then, and I think if you look at Merritt's work you can see this is when power is taken away consensually, or when it's given in you know, times that are not usual, is a way that as creators, like if we have some budding creators in here, to think about like how you can think about, you know, consent with your game with a player, is to very purposefully see how agency is being given and taken away, and are you doing that in a thoughtful manner, in a way that you want to you know, give a message to someone. And in Consensual Torture Simulator, you very, very clearly have those sort of boundaries of what you want to do. Even, and the best part about it is kind of, you know, for the top in that. Like, after a while, I was like, I need to stop. You know, I need to stop. And that was the most interesting thing for me to find out, was that, wow, I even have my own. And I think that's kind of an interesting aspect to thinking about consent in play, even if your game has nothing to do with sex. Consent is, you know, lurking around corners in those, in these sort of in games and these usual themes.
Okay.
Did I drop mic? Or?
Push it. Yeah. Do it.
Wow, everyone has good thoughts on this. Well, yeah, I mean, like. Well, like, so then, like, where, and this goes into, like, I mean, this goes into any interactive media. So this can be video games, this can be interactive fiction, and this can even go into, like, you know, film or journalism. Like, I guess, like, in what ways does trying to cast somebody into a power fantasy rob them of their own agency? In the sense that, like, you know, so many games like have this like juvenile like hero fantasy where you're, you know, you're Earth's last hope or something like that, and like, where does the line go between empowerment and like, you know, sort of writing over somebody's like agency, and like, does like to what extent does interactive narrative, like, are there ways for interactive narratives to allow you to progress through a story without necessarily like making your decisions and personality for you? Okay.
Yes. I'm a text-based adventure gamer, like, so a lot of these questions don't really work for the kinds of games that I play, I guess, because you're not really personified at all. You're just text on a screen. You're often not even described.
Mm-hmm.
But actually, you know, okay, I can talk a little bit about this as it pertains to Zork, which is like my favorite game ever. Because I feel like in Zork, you can just wander around pretty much forever. And like, you can make the decision whether you want to draw a giant map, if you're obsessive like that, which I am, or, you know, just explore. And there's some consequences to that, but I think that in general, there is that feeling of freedom where you almost don't have to make any decisions about your personality or how you want to describe yourself, because there's nobody else to talk to. There's only gurus, and they'll just eat you. They don't care. They don't care about your personality. So I think that for me, that works really well. And that might actually be why I feel alienated from other kinds of games, to be honest.
Can I bring it back to like the reverse scenario? Mm-hmm. So games that like deliberately take away your power. And I think Spec Ops, for the most part, doesn't do that. Like it's mostly like a power fantasy, right? But I think there is this trend in kind of like if you want to like make your game like really edgy and you're like just one person like developing it on your own, mm-hmm. What you do apparently is berate the player. So I've played a few games over the last few years where like you just like start up and it's like you're worthless, like you're scum. You think you can like beat me? I'm like, it's like this really like again, getting back to that idea of like, well, why are you doing that? Like, what is the goal, I guess? And could we actually maybe like shift right here to talk about like content warnings and stuff? Because I feel like that's super relevant. Mm-hmm. So like, does everyone know like what a content warning is? Like when you like, at the beginning of like a piece of media, you're like, hey, this piece of media is gonna contain like these things that a lot of people might find really upsetting. And like, I think those things can be super useful. And it's like an interesting contrast, I think, to like you think about the way that mainstream games are rated, like the ESRB. It's just like I don't remember the last time I saw like an actual video game box, but like it's like everyone, like cartoon comic violence or something, like just things like that, and it's like pretty useless in actually deciding whether or not you want to engage with a piece of media or not. And so like I think this idea of like having a content warning of like, I don't think all media is always responsible to be like, hey, just so you know, this movie includes, like, the following things, like, all of this stuff. But, like, you know, it can be useful. And, like, as a creator, I want to think about, like, if I'm including something about, like, sexual violence in, like, a game, like, why am I doing that? And, like, also, I want to, like, take care of my players, right? Like, if that's, like, a pretty heavy topic. So, like, I'm going to let people know beforehand so, like, they don't necessarily have to go in and just get, like, bushwhacked by that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's been this interest. Well, maybe it's not really an interesting conversation, but there's just been a conversation around content warnings lately, especially when it comes to like spoilers or when it comes to prepping people, and in a way that is kind of like, you know, this unawareness of consent and of how people take up other people's space or, you know, project other people's, you know, their value onto other people. And I think it's what it really is a lack of creativity. I think we can think of creative ways to inform players of content and things that we know are very commonly material that people find sensitive. Or, if anything, finding creative ways to deliver that content to people who are usually triggered. Or, if you will, making games particularly for people who are triggered by certain things. And that makes a whole bunch of sense to have a content warning, right? Because you want those people to know it and to go into it knowing that. So I think what is most interesting is the creative potential of content warnings. I recently have been playing some games that have a lot of, you know, are about heavy things. And there was just this, a couple that like made it really obtuse to find out what the trigger warning was. Like they'll go, you know, like, this has a trigger warning, but if you don't want to be spoiled, don't go and see the trigger warning. It's just like, well, I mean, I guess I don't want to be spoiled, but what if this makes me feel like utter shit? Like, I don't want that. So it's. I think, especially when we have things like Twine that make it really easy to play with text and labels and things like that, that can organize information very easily. I can imagine like, hey, here are the content warnings. Click the ones you don't want to see, and then just takes all the labels of those things away from your game. That's not an impossible thing to happen, and it's a really nice thing to do for people. You're like, well, I still want to enjoy your game. I just don't want to see the certain thing that will, you know, make me upset.
The last time that I tried making a Twine game, I tried making an interactive content warning, where like the game just kept asking you questions about how you were doing. and like what you've been up to. And I ended up spending so much time on that that I never finished the game because I was just like really, I was just really into this idea about a game that's just like, so what's your, what would you say your trauma level's at today? Have you thought about calling this number?
Yeah.
You should finish it.
So to get, to make this like somewhat analogous to pinball, because I feel like I need to prove that I do belong here. I have like taken both Kitty and Merritt out to play pinball at the Pacific Pinball Museum, which I have flyers for if you want to come up to me after the panel. And one of the things, and like part of like teaching someone how to play pinball, and I talk about this a lot in my writing, is that there's no unifying concept of pinball. That it's, that's made up. It's bullshit. Mm-hmm. At the on every pinball machine, the bottom left, there are what we call title cards or rule cards, and it explicitly tells you how to play the machine. And every machine is different. Every machine has different objectives, has a different play style. In fact, you know, a lot of, you know, everyone thinks of, when you think of pinball, you think of flippers. Flippers didn't get invented like in pinball till the 50s. And everyone thinks of multi-ball as a common feature. That shit didn't happen until like near the 60s. And so like breaking away from pinball is this like universal ideal of pinball and treating each machine as its own narrative and its own set of rules, I find has been really helpful for me in like negotiating like relationships. Because rather than treating this like this universal, like here's how women date women, or like here's, you know, like here's how I handle dating men. Like I try to treat each person as an individual like set of guidelines. And like I don't want to say like rules and play styles because that sounds really.
I was gonna say, do they get title cards?
Yeah.
Do you want a title card?
That would be so handy, right? I would be really relieved to see people have title cards. That would be really nice.
Like exchange and be like, hey.
Imagine how OkCupid would be different. Wow.
And I think about, and I think that ties in a little bit into like the importance of content warnings because like a lot of people are survivors, but not everyone, not every survivor is going to be like made visible, like visibly like upset to their stomach, like over the mention of the word rape. You know, or not every survivor is going to like have a panic attack if you tell them about your experience. And so like, I think it's important that when we talk about trigger warnings and content warnings, we also talk about ways that we can make them more accessible for people of like different needs.
I also think what's interesting about content warnings, a friend of mine posted about this on Twitter. He pointed out that like, he doesn't understand why people are so weirded out by trigger warnings or content warnings, considering it's like an index, and that's like really helpful to have. Like the more we can index media, the better, then we can find the things that we want to find. So why would you ask for less data as opposed to more? Mm-hmm. And I think that that's a really interesting point too.
I think there's this like weird resistance to trigger warnings, like it comes from like a few different places, right? So like you have like the Jack Halberstam school of like kids are whiners these days, and like why
the
aren't they cool? Like
amazing though.
Yeah, it's like pretty all right. I've heard that whoever runs it is like really attractive and like intelligent, but like there's also this weird resistance like that comes from a totally different place, which is like spoiler culture, I feel like. Mm-hmm. And it's like, if you say that a piece of media has sexual violence in it, oh, you spoil it, I can't enjoy it anymore because like I know that something happens in it. And like, it's this really weird like artifact of like the internet and like online culture that like, yeah, if you like are made aware of any detail of something, it suddenly loses all value, which is like that, if that's the case, then it probably wasn't that great to begin with.
Right.
Like. And I see a lot of resistance to that kind of thing, like to trigger warnings coming from that. Like, oh, I don't want to know going in because I want to be surprised or whatever. It's like,
but
I don't want to be
surprised. Why are the surprises always traumatic?
Right.
Like, right, yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
I think that that's, again, that's that lack of creativity. If, like, your way of personifying somebody is through trauma or your way of moving your protagonist along is through trauma, through their trauma or somebody else's trauma, you're not being very creative. I mean, people manage to move through the world without being traumatized all the time.
And it's really,
I hope.
Yeah, it's super lazy and it's like super gendered too, right? Because like if you want to make a woman character interesting, like she has been raped. If you want to make a male character interesting, then like a woman close to him has been raped. Like that's like just like the thing
woman
that people
fridge.
Do. Yeah, exactly.
It's also using trauma as a teaching tool. Like like in movies or games when something really like traumatic and like really gross happens and it's meant to like teach you the viewer like the importance of friendship or some shit. And like,
hey, friendship is magic.
But you know, like I feel like a lot of police procedurals are especially like egregiously guilty of this, of like showing you something really gross and unhappy and like bad, but like being like, well, I'm teaching you, the viewer, like a lesson in empathy or a lesson about how hard some people have it. And like, I didn't sign up for this. I didn't go to the registrar and like enroll in this lesson. Yeah. Like I didn't like agree to have this lesson taught to me. And that like gets into this, like, you know, this thing of like, you know, now that games and certain like media, comics, et cetera, are more ubiquitous with the internet, like everybody's out there to like, you know, teach us their brand of like how the world works and like is trying to like teach us their viewpoint through shock.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, and they treat these like various types of trauma as if you can just say sexual violence and that means the same thing across the board. I mean, I think that you could, for example, talk about it or like see it, find it in a journal or something versus like actually witnessing the action taking place. I mean, like there's different ways that these kinds of trauma manifest in games and in other media. So I don't know, I feel like it can be too general sometimes because like there are certain things that I'm not going to be triggered by and there are certain things that I will be. And now I just, anytime I want to enjoy any media, I just look up the name of it and critique and then read that. And honestly, I don't understand why it ruins media for other people because like if the media is good, no amount of somebody else describing it to me is going to ruin it for me because it's good. And I'd rather sort of see the artist's vision, but maybe that's just me, I don't know.
I mean, that gets into this like really interesting, so that, I'm sorry, I'm talking a lot, though I'm the moderator, but that gets into like a really good parallel of human intimacy, right? This idea that silence is sexy, that if you can get a thing that you want without negotiation, then it's a conquest, that it's like good, that you're good at sex, you know, rather than like through negotiation. And I feel like this spoiler culture is like that. Where like, if you have to like not know what a story's about or not know what media is about to enjoy it, that like you can't just enjoy, you can't like know what you're getting and then enjoy having it. I think that like creates this weird like culture of silence, like in both in media and in like relationships.
Well, so. and there's this idea that it's better to ask forgiveness than permission, right? Mm-hmm. So I feel like that definitely influences this as well. Because is it really? I don't actually think that it is. But that seems, you know, it's a common cliche.
Can we... this is like a bit of a detour, but can we dismantle like the bullshit argument that like always comes up around like consent in games and like sexual violence and like sex in games of like that, like whenever, like I've seen so many forum threads devolve from like, oh look, this is an interesting game about like sexual violence or about like about consent or about kink. And like some bro will always be like, well, it's okay to murder people in games, so why isn't it okay to sexually assault people? And it's just like, people are just like, well, I don't know. And it's like, there are really good reasons why that's not okay, yeah. Right? Like, we don't have a culture where, like, murder is, like, you know, where we're not encouraged to, like, report murder, and, like, where there's, like, we don't have, like, a murder culture, right? I mean, I guess you could say it in ways we do, but, like, that's total bullshit, right? Has anyone else come across that argument?
I mean, that's, yeah, I mean, yeah, and, I mean, like that, like the whole like murdering people in games, like that's a whole.
Yeah, I mean, I also think we should probably be murdering fewer people in games. So yeah. The premise itself is kind of faulty.
Can we, do you feel okay talking about like some of the like bullshit you got around Consensual Torture Simulator?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Do you wanna?
Do you have anything specific in mind, or should I just like bring up my list of grudges?
Please.
Okay. Yeah, I know. Like, I mean, I think it's pretty predictable. Like, so I released a game called Consensual Torture Simulator. It's a text-based game about a kink relationship. So like, the player is a top, and like the context of the game is like you're in this long-term relationship with this other person, and basically the gameplay is just like choosing like a bunch of different like implements, including your hand or like a flogger or whatever, and then like choosing like how to like to strike your partner who is like wants you to, and like the goal is to make her cry. And the interesting thing is like a lot of people like couldn't get to that point. Like we're just like, oh, I'm too worried about this fictional character who isn't real and doesn't exist, so I'm gonna like stop the scene early, which is an option you have in the game, which sort of tells me that I like that's kind of like good feedback, I think. But yeah, I got a lot of responses to the game from like from rando like commenters on like game sites, but also like Jezebel posted about it, and that was fun. And it was just like they were just like, yeah, no one can consent to being hit. Like no one can consent to power dynamics. And it's like, well, the 70s called and they want their sexual politics back. And yeah, like it's so strange that like there are all of these like really egregious violations of consent like we've been talking about in mainstream games, but like no one bats an eye at them. And as soon as someone like makes a game about a setting that is like explicitly consensual, people are like, whoa, I don't know, man. I don't know. Consensual depictions of sexuality, that's where we gotta draw the line. Like, yes. Murdering people, teabagging people's bodies, it's totally okay. But consensual sex is just like, I'm uncomfortable with that. So yeah, like I think that's pretty predictable. Like, and I think that's one reason why depictions of sex like aren't like consensual sex aren't as common in games still, because there is this like fear of like reprisal or something, or it's like not received very well.
Which is so interesting to me, because like, you know, spending time on like FetLife, for example, it's so interesting to me that there would be all this backlash about a game where it's consensual, and yet every time I go to a play space, it feels like there is that guy doing that scene and not really talking to their partner about it and is kind of swaggering around about it. And I feel like that's very much a part of, and I would say not even just BDSM culture, but culture in general, this idea of conquering or winning, I guess. And it's so fascinating to me that you would have all this backlash when the BDSM community seems to really validate and encourage that kind of thing. I mean, I can't even count the number of profiles I've seen where guys are talking extensively about how sociopathic they are. Mm-hmm. And yet they're like pillars of the community, which is fucking terrifying. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think this was mostly from people who were like not aware that there was a BDSM community, yeah. Probably. And were just like, this doesn't look right to me. And it's also interesting because people like gendered the main character. Mm-hmm. Like they were like, it's not okay for a dude to hit a lady. And it was like, well, the main character doesn't actually get gendered at all in the game, but I was pretty clearly thinking of it as a woman. Mm-hmm. So it's interesting that like you'd go to that image that you have in your head of like BDSM as like a man hitting a woman, right. But like that's real, but yeah.
Do you think that it could be that that like it's rather than an aversion to consensual pain, it's more that for cis hetero male gamers that if the violence isn't unwanted on the part of the like of the subject, that it's no longer valuable?
Well, I think it makes people uncomfortable, definitely. Yeah. Yeah, but like, so like games, like our whole concept of like digital games and like most of our whole concept of like games at all is like about competition, mm-hmm. and is about like domination, or like it doesn't have to be, but it often is, right? And it's like almost always about like accomplishing a goal or like beating your opponents, and like cooperative games and play just like aren't really as valued, it seems to me. Mm-hmm. And so like when you try and introduce something like that, people are like, wait a minute, is this like, is this a game? Like, who am I trying to beat? How do I win? And they get kind of like weirded out by that.
In a weird way, it's kind of like people are unsettled that someone could exhibit agency in those sort of situations. Like, through my agency, because I like, basically it's like, okay, a character that is used to being objectified, like in our media, women are objectified very often, and lots of other people are too. And then when you get someone, you know, a woman who's in a, you know, sexual situation, you know, with agency saying, I am forcing you to, or not maybe not forcing, but like, I am presenting myself to you and I want this, and this is what I want. And that people, and it's almost kind of like, well, you know, because I'm not forcing my power onto you, I have a problem with it. It's kind of how a lot of this these conversations seem to go. And people are kind of uncomfortable with the idea that like a power exchange can be explicit. Like people, because like when it's implicit, like, you know, we're talking about power systems and games all the time, people kind of ignore it. They're just like, you're reading into it or whatever. And then when it's made explicit, it's usually made explicit in a, you know, in these consensual manner. And that's when power dynamics are obviously bad. So it's kind of weird. Oh, cool. Is there a question?
Yeah.
Cool.
I don't know if you want questions, but, you know.
Yeah, why not?
Yeah.
Questions. Yeah.
Right.
But, you know, like they say, like, you know, or why is there, you know, there has to be rape in it. It's realistic.
Right.
So there's this, like, there's this weird, like, flip flop of, you know, I'll argue which one everyone is interesting. And it's sort of like when I, you know, consent to enter into your world by playing this game, what am I consenting to? Am I consenting to maximum realism, or am I consenting to escape?
Yeah, I think what's really interesting right now, especially with some of the games that you might see that are up in, you know, up in the fifth floor and such, is that with games and authors being a lot more present in the piece, like the idea that the game doesn't need you as a player. Like the game is very content on its own to exist in the way that it wants to. And if you don't want to play by its rules, then, you know, go play something else. And I think a lot of people, and I think about this from a, you know, a professional standpoint, like a lot of people who are uncomfortable with the idea of authors and games caring about themselves more than the players. And the idea that the player isn't some like holy shrine that should always have everything tailored towards them is something I think that these games disrupt. And something that, you know, that players very often want are not consistent, they're self-centered, and they're, you know, whatever, and it goes around that. And a lot of game design is built around that. A lot of game design is player-centric playtesting. So when you have, like, these games, like, I'm not, like for me, I didn't playtest my game, and I didn't kind of care about what anybody thought, you know, thought should go on in it. And I know a lot of people were resentful of that. But at the same time, I feel like you would lose something if we're talking about these sort of subjects, that we must think of the player as the person who should have power and agency and thought and everything. So I think there's an interesting aesthetic clash going on right now with that. Any other thoughts?
I think that's true for a lot of different kinds of media, actually, because I think that with writing, too, there's this sense of, with film, there's a sense of, the audience, you have to cater to the audience, you have to do what the audience wants, what the market wants, otherwise you won't have success. And in various industries that I've been in, I have been really stubborn about that and been like, no, this is what I want to do. This is what I'm going to do. And I'm going to find a way to monetize that. And because I've always found that there are people, there is a market, there are people who want what it is you're creating. And so I think that, I mean, it's kind of like painting. I can't imagine a painter being like, all right, well, I'm only going to paint the things that I already see in the galleries, like, because that is what the market wants. You know, I mean, it's about expression, right? And there should be some part of you in it, and it should be about the thing that you want to convey. If you're only focusing on the audience and the market, then the market never expands, and it's never challenged, and there's nothing new.
Yeah. Can I jump into?
Yeah.
Yeah. Like the whole selective realism defense is like really frustrating, right? And I think it speaks to like a lack of imagination. Like I think it is used like cynically, but I think also people just like a lot of people just like cannot imagine what it would be like to have a culture that where there was like no sexual violence in the way that we know it now. Like. It's just like we're projecting our social values into like this fantasy world where there's lasers and spaceships and stuff, but like everything else is like totally the same. Except we just like leave out whole groups of people because like we like don't really want to include them for some reason. So yeah, that's like really super frustrating. And I think, yeah, like it does come from this like lack of imagination and like we can do better, right? And like a really like useful way for me to like deal with this stuff and like to think about it has been to categorize that stuff as boring. Like, I think like the usual response is like, oh, it's really problematic that you don't have that in your game. And like people just hear problematic and like their brain just shuts off, right?
Yeah.
And also, what does that word mean? It's like, that's like a, you know, like a grad school seminar filler word. But boring is really great because it's super dismissive. And it's just like, oh yeah, your sci-fi fantasy world where I can like, yeah, do like FTL travel and like have like mind powers and stuff, but like no one can conceive of being in like a relationship with more than one person at once. That's really boring. Yeah. This is like really boring, guys. And like it's just, I really like how cutting that is. I don't know if that's actually helping anything, but.
I'm gonna try that.
This maybe betray like how out of like digital and like current games that I am, but like I immediately went to Hideo Kojima and Metal Gear Solid. So like in Metal Gear Solid, those of you who owned a PlayStation, you fight a guy who can control, who can like enter your mind and make you do stuff. You fight a guy who can control ravens, and you fight like a woman who, like a sniper who talks to wolves. And it's full of just this, like, it's all this magic, and like, it's all of this, like, supernatural violence. You end up, like, and throughout the game, like, they, tying this back to what we were talking about with, like, bad decisions, where, like, the game constantly reminds you how many people you've killed. And then at the end, they're like, oh, did you know they were all your brothers? Like, and then at the end, they're like, you know, they tie this all into, like, the selfish gene. Like, you fought a guy who, like, moves things with his mind, and at the end of the game, they talk about, like, the meaning of all life is just to reproduce. That's all this is about. Like, yeah, it's just this, like, constantly, like, going back and forth to, like, of just, like, you know, sort of, like, almost like a carrot in a stick. Great question. Do we have any other questions?
Ooh, lots of questions.
A lot of people have really harmful and bad ideas of what consent is, I think, in the culture at large. And I was wondering if you thought that games have a place in educating people about that, or what games can do in maybe even big AAA style games and like small indie games, like where those all fit into teaching people about what consent is and what that means.
Well, yeah. Oh, do you want to go?
You go.
No, you.
Go. No, you.
Oh, we're stuck in a polite list loop. Okay. So two things. So like on the indie side, I made a game called Super Consent like last week or 2 weeks ago. It's like hardly even like a game. It's like a 2-minute Twine thing. And like the point of it is just like there's like a cycling link that you click and like it changes the word. And it's like, hey, do you want to do a thing? And it starts off as like dot, dot, dot. And as you click it, it goes from like less certain to like more certain. So it's like, you start clicking and it's like, maybe, like, yeah, like, I guess. And then like, it finally gets to like, no or yes. And like, I think that's like something we need to talk about is like, it's hard to, it can be hard to like make definite statements like that sometimes. And so like getting people, like having people practice that can be really useful. And the other thing that that game does is if you say no, so like if you're unsure twice, it's like, well, it sounds like you're not really sure. So like, let's not do the thing if you're not like 100% or like as close to 100% as you can reasonably get. And if you say no, the response isn't like, oh, well, like that's okay, whatever. It's like, oh, thank you for saying no. Like, thank you for trusting me like to say no, because that's like a really hard thing to do, right? So like what I wanna see, and like, this could have already happened already, and like I don't actually play that many like huge games because I'm kind of poor. But like, I want a Mass Effect game or like a Dragon Age game, like in the new Dragon Age, like where's like David Gator, is he in here? okay, I want like an NPC who like doesn't just like say, okay, yeah, like I'll fuck you after you've like made all the correct dialogue choices. I want an NPC who like at the end is like, oh, I really like you, but like, and I don't want to do this thing with you. Does that happen? No, okay. that you're like, yeah, yeah, no, totally, because that'd be really exciting. Yeah, I want people to see that it's like not like sex and consent and stuff isn't just like mechanical. It's not like making the right dialogue choices, and like sometimes someone just like doesn't want to do something for like reasons that could have nothing to do with you. And I think it would be really rad if like at the culmination of, you know, because like Bioware games have like the, you romance someone over the course of the game, and like right before the really bad thing happens, you're like, this could be our last night of life, we have to do something. And it would be cool if they were like, I'm not really feeling up to it.
Right.
Like, you know, if we get through this thing, then like maybe we can talk more, but like I don't really want to fuck just because we might get blown up by the Reapers or whatever.
Right.
That would be really cool.
My partner was actually just playing Saints Row 4, I think, God. And that actually, there is kind of a situation that he had that happened, where his character asked the two people on the ship, and one of them was like, no, I'm not really into it. And the other person punches the main, your character in the face, and then like mounts you, which is, you know, kind of,
I love
kind
Sandra
of how
Force.
I ascertain consent personally, but I really appreciated that those were both there, you know, and also I think that it's the male character who says, no, I'm not really feeling it. And I think that it's so weird to me often, the things that I find in Saints Row games that I'm like, really?
It's a really amazing, Saints Row 4 is amazing when it comes to sex.
It's kind of fantastic.
It's actually really good, yeah.
So I'm happy to see stuff like that is happening.
Yeah, I think actually what's, also if you're looking into game creation, things like that, it's really easy to see how creators are kind of focused on systems and rules, and consent and rules are two things that very easily go together and can be made very exaggerated. So games, I'm not gonna say games are more suited to it or anything, though there is untapped potential to it, players very often when they play games are learning the game as they go, and so they know how to talk to the game, basically. And I think that it's good to, as an analog, be able to be like, okay, well, this is all about rules and such. Well, we can, in consent, we can kind of figure that out. I'm actually kind of thinking about right now, just Emily Short did this game called Galatea. It's one of my favorites. That got me back into gaming, actually. And what I really like about Galatea is you are having a conversation with a piece of artwork over and over and over again. And she has all these different reactions that that gives to you. And, you know, when you're a jerk to her, she acts like, wow, you're a jerk and I'm not gonna talk to you. And there's all these other things. And there's something interesting and worthwhile in the idea of kind of like an actual social simulation, you know, or a situation where you can practice these things. And I find that, you know, the framework is already there, so. Yeah. There was a question.
Yeah, I want to, you in the white shirt?
Oh, we touched on a little bit of it already, but I just wanted to bring up the concept of enthusiastic consent, and I was a little bit curious. I mean, you touched a little bit on what that would look like in a game, so I'm curious about that. I think that Consensual Torture Simulator actually did a really good job with that, because it requires affirmative every step of the way you're consenting as the player to go forward. and you can choose to end the scene at any time. So I was just curious about that and how you think that it would look like to ask enthusiastic consent of the player in a game. But yeah, you touched on a lot of it already.
Well, there's a lot of... So something that I feel very often is missed in video games is the idea that it's video, you know, it's audiovisual. And very often people don't experiment with audiovisual feedback in games. And I can imagine very easily, like, you know, temperature colors and screens, or when you say something, the amount of stars that burst out of them, you know, something like that. You know, like just the idea that you can sense, you know, visually in some way when someone is reading a certain way. And let's say someone doesn't have like rainbow shooting out of their, you know, face each time they say yes. They're like, okay, well, I didn't see, you know, that. Like, can I ask again? Like, do you really want this or do you whatever? And, you know, I can see a game that could train or go that way. So you eventually are into that. So I think we can see, because very often in talking about BDSM or kink in general, one thing that is very important is reading body language of your partner, getting used to your partner, understanding, you know, what are their tics? What are the things that you can sense? Like, oh, we're going into a bad territory. And I think that's a great skill that an audiovisual medium can do, is be like, okay, well, I'm not sensing the 100% what is going on here. So I think there is a lot to be explored that way.
I just want to interject before the actual panelists carry on the conversation. But something I feel like a lot of, and this isn't necessarily, like, I feel like a lot of the conversations around enthusiastic consent can be sort of exclusive of sex workers and, like, other people for whom, like, who, you know, have sex and don't feel coerced about it or, like, but also at the same time aren't, like, gung-ho, but also at the same time, you know, like, tying kink into games, I have lately, as I get older, felt less and less loyal to the concept of the safe word. I feel like a lot of people sort of rely on this, on the safe word. I feel like it, like, while, like, a lot of people have good intentions behind the safe word, I feel like it doesn't really do a whole lot of good. I feel like if you get to a place in a scene where you just don't have the, like, mental or emotional faculty to safe word, because you're just, like, not there, and then it's like, oh, well, you didn't say the safe word, so I'm gonna keep going. I feel like me personally, as a dom and as a kinkster, I'm trying to move to a more organic, holistic sort of approach to consent, because I feel like a concept of the safe word is actually really limiting.
I mean, enthusiastic consent's a really interesting one for me as a sex worker, as a porn performer, as well. We had actually had a conversation about authenticity and how authenticity is a big keyword, particularly for ethical or feminist porn, or what's called ethical and feminist porn. That's a whole nother conversation. And I find that to encourage or to idealize enthusiastic consent or authenticity in sex is to not necessarily acknowledge, again, the systematic pressures. Sometimes I have sex not because I'm super enthusiastic about it or gung-ho about it, but because, you know, I feel some sense of, sorry, this is gonna be a little TMI possibly, but I feel like it's interesting to think of it, to think of sex drives as like an old car that needs some time to warm up, and you need to leave it running for a while, and then eventually it will start. Well, some, you know, I think libidos can be like that as well, and so sometimes, because I want to get to that end goal, I might have not unenthusiastic consent, but like feel comfortable with the amount of consent that I can give. And I think that that's also very valid and very important to create space for variations of consent and just having more conversations about that and saying, well, I mean, I'm not like super excited about it, but mm-hmm. I'm excited about the end goal, and therefore, you know, I want to make this choice. And I mean, I could talk endlessly about consent under capitalism, uh-huh. where your consent isn't really very important. You know, you have to work in order to make money, in order to live. And therefore, you know, I think consent can get really complicated. But at the same time, I think it's an important conversation to have, because it would be a nice end goal.
Cool. All right.
Oh, maybe we could move on.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Just two other people with questions.
Okay, all right. Yeah.
Okay, cool. Oh. Oops, I forgot what I was going to say. I think get back to the question that came from over there too. I mean, you know, how can you model this? And I mean, the best thing that we could do, getting back to games, would I think be like getting it away from the RPG heritage of, you know, consent is a one-time skill check, right? You know, the, like, you know, and which I think you started to touch on. And you know, where is this? You know, where's the romance aspect in, you know, the BioWare games where, you know, like you have sex with somebody once and they're like, eh, that really didn't like do it for me, and I'm like, I'm kind of done with you, sorry. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, midway, not like it should be like a quick time sex simulator, but like, you know, you have a conversation and it goes poorly and they're like, I don't really feel so good anymore. Like I'm leaving, sorry. That was fun, but okay. You're not the person I thought you were. And you know, the idea that it's an ongoing thing, and I mean, if we're gonna you know, put fantastic elements that we would like to see, like space travel and lasers and mind powers, like why can't we put, you know, that consent is an ongoing relationship, especially in intimacy, and that can be withdrawn. And you know, on top of that, that's not the end of the world. It's just, you know, you have to like deal with the consequences of that if you want to continue to have a decent relationship with that person, right? I mean, like, you know, that, like, and games can be a safe space to explore that, to like, you know, go through that cycle and be like, wow, why did that happen? How do I feel about that? You know, and, you know, for game creators to sort of put there like, well, this is, you know, this is what I want to see and what, you know, my thoughts about this, and I've thought about this more than you have because I'm a game designer and, you know, you're just a player. But
yeah, someone do that.
Yeah, basically it's
or BioWare give me a job and hire Maddie or something.
I'll do it. I would say, like, you know, what's really unfortunate with a lot of romances in games is that it has a lot of, I feel like especially they take from, dating sims, especially not good ones that are on, like, Newgrounds or something. And these dating sims, you know, tend to have, like, a gotta catch them all sort of way of treating women. And I think you see that when you know I enjoy BioWare games, like, you know, I say it all the time. I'm not going to not say, like, you know, all I have to do is say the right conversations and maybe get the right trinket so they sleep with me. Actually, I've been going on a no sleeping run through actually, because yeah, it feels good. But I think if we can at least think about, you know, what is the narrative around romance in games right now, like, you know, Who are the people writing the romances, and, like, you know, is there certain expectations of that? And I think it would be interesting to try and simulate different kinds of relationships, like imagine a different kind of couple or a different kind of different ways. And I think that's something, like, you know, people here can think of easily. Like, I mean, queer people probably did not meet partners the same way that, you know, non-queer people did. Like high school for me was like kind of a barren wasteland of sadness, you know? So, and that's not an uncommon thing. Like, you know, when you're threatened with violence, you know, you tend to not, you know, put yourself out there. And then when you're not used to it, and then when you can only find people in designated spaces or designated online spaces, you know, that's a whole different story. That's a whole different way of, like, trying to approach people for intimacy and sex. Like, can you imagine if, you know, actually, Dennis Farr actually, I think, wrote a small little piece about, like, what if, you know, Commander Shepard was, you know, really queer, you know, he would be taking out, like, Grindr, you know, not like just kind of walking up to someone and saying, hey, you're gay, let's do it. You know, like, it's not quite a thing that quite happens so often. So I think there's different ways of, like, romance is just different ways that people meet each other for intimacy that is just not thought of in games. And boy meets girl, you know, you don't sub out all the identities and sexualities and voila, you got, you know, queerness. You know, you have different relationships. And of course, like with like race and disability and a whole range of other things that, you know, if you wanted to model consent in relationships, you would have a lot of variety. There's another question over here, wasn't there? Yeah.
All right. Some players like really traumatic, hardcore, triggering games. They want to have that sort of experience. A lot of this talk has been about protecting, you know, consent is about protecting players from that when they need it. So I was wondering, what games have you seen that were like pushing the limits hardcore but had a good consent system? Mm-hmm. Here's an example. I play a game, it's a MUD, a text-based adventure game a lot. You have to ask consent in order to have a scene, and if they don't consent, it still happens. You'll still get maimed or tortured or whatever horrible thing, but it's faded on. And I think that's really elegant. It allows for like really high consequence, like, you know, shocking stuff to happen while still buffering the player. So, I mean, we talked a lot about Consensual Torture Simulator because it is a good example, but I'm just interested in any other games you've encountered that are really, you know, pushing the limits of, you know, what is triggering, what is dangerous, but allows you to opt out.
Hmm. Well, first I wanted to say, like, is consent about protecting players? I feel that consent maybe shouldn't be thought of as just a like a shield, because it's a process. It's an ongoing process. I mean, like, your first initial bare minimum consent is starting the game, right? And so then, as you continue to play the game, you're making these little steps throughout, right? But it's not necessarily about protecting you. It's about having a rapport. So I would initially just want to start that conversation with that idea, because I would hate the idea of consent to be, oh, it's like this massive shield to prevent people who are oversensitive. I think that that's boring.
Yeah, I think for me personally, consent is getting what I want. You know, mm-hmm. Consent is like, you're going to do this for me, you're going to agree to do this for me, and we're going to do it, and we're going to enjoy it. Consent isn't necessarily like, You know, usually if I was to model consent with someone, through that negotiation, I'm just going to model this joint experience that both of us are going to like. They're going to evade the things that we don't like. So in a sense, like, you know, for the most part, the things I like are going to not be the things I don't like. So in a sense, consent is used, can be used for people to be like, okay, what is it that you want? You know, what is it that I want? And where do we meet? You violate consent when that misses, right? It's not consent to just offer consent and then not actually go through the process of finding out what is it that you want. Because like to say, like, you know, to get someone to consent, like, you know, can I hit you? And if I just say yes and then don't clarify how, where, how often, at what velocity, with what objects, with, you know, out the window, you know, like, I just want to know, like, what's going to, you know, through space and time, like, I just need to know exactly what you're going to do. So I think it's, a consent is a vested interest, you know, that is both selfish and, you know, wanting to pleasure the other person. So I wouldn't ever want to, so I think it's good that you bring it up, that we wouldn't want to coach consent into just some shield, but rather some engendering sexual agency. That's kind of a better way, I would say, of thinking of consent.
Or even just agency, yeah. In general.
No, just agency, period. Yeah, you're right. Mm-hmm.
Okay, I want to talk about two games really quick. One's a bad example, I think one's a good example. Okay, I always hate like talking shit on stuff because like the person could be in the audience and be like really sad. So in many ways, this game Beloved is like really interesting, and it's like a side-scrolling platformer, like where you just sort of like move this little character along, and periodically there's like this like voice of like the designer, almost this like godlike voice, yeah. And it's just like telling you to do things. It's like jump over the spikes, and then at one part it's like kill yourself, like jump into the spikes. But like it's like there was some discussion when like it was first released about like, is this game about like kink and consent, or is this game about abuse? And like, if it's a game about abuse, then like, okay, fair enough. But like, the very first thing that happens in that game is like, are you a boy or a girl? And when you answer that, it's like, no. It's like, I'm a girl. It's like, no, you're a boy. And it's like, cool, awesome. that's like a really different experience for like someone who has experience being misgender than it would be for someone who doesn't, right? So I was just like, well, I'm done with you. Right. And like, I thought that was not a great example. And like, it's an interesting game in ways, but like, yeah. The game that is a really good example of something that does like really intense, like violent stuff, has like sex stuff. Like, there's no sexual violence in it, I don't think, but there's like pretty intense other forms of violence, is this game Sabbath, which is like one of my favorite games. It's made in Twine. It's on itch.io, I think. And at the beginning of the game, it's like, first things first, which dumplings, what you got in your drawers, and it's like penis or vagina, but picking that doesn't actually choose your gender, which is kind of interesting. It doesn't change how the game refers to you. And also there's an updated version that the creator made where it's like, in the original game, so it's a game about sacrificing animals to like warp your body into this like horrific monstrosity and like instate full communism and take over the world. It's super funny.
Why haven't I heard of this?
But after it was released, the creator released like an updated version where you can choose not to have to do the animal stuff. Like, you can be like, I don't want to murder like a crow in this game. So you just use like candles instead. And I thought that was like an interesting way to like modify the game, because it doesn't necessarily like destroy or break the game, but it does mean it's like available to a wider range of people who don't want to like enact violence against animals in play. Play Sabbath.
So I have two examples of much older games that I like. So the first is Mutant League Football. It was a nothing. Wow, shit. So it's a football game for the Sega Genesis, released in the early 90s. And it's a football game, but there's landmines on the field, and you're robots and trolls and lizard folk, and you can literally kill each other. You can literally kill a player, and then they're out of the game. And you can actually set in the actual game, and those settings before you start a game, how violent you want it to be. And if you put one, then you're really only gonna like lose a player if you run over a landmine or a fire pit. But if you go to five, I've been playing this game for 20 years. I played it since I was a little boy, and I have never finished a game on the highest level of violence, because you run out of players and you forfeit. And I think that, and like it almost just becomes almost like a war simulator where you and your opponent just try to kill each other until you run out of soldiers. And I think that's really good. And another thing that is like, not necessarily the same as far as like sex in games, because I play pinball, but I actually really enjoy in shooters when you can limit the weapons that you can have. Like, I remember being a kid and like playing GoldenEye with little kids, and like you do the slapping, which
yes.
which is like silly and like, you know, goofy and like, well, you know, what is the difference between slapping someone to death and shooting them? But like, you know, for some people who may like have an adverse reaction to guns but still want to play GoldenEye.
Slapping with paintball, you know, because you can, like, in GoldenEye, whenever you shoot things, you can leave, like, a paintball mark.
Yeah,
no,
yeah.
But with slapping, I haven't done it with slapping. Huh. I'll have to try that.
You can also, in Turok, in the second Turok game, you can be a velociraptor. And it was a lot of fun as a kid to, like, everyone be raptors. And yes. just run around and just, like, lunging on each other. I'm sorry.
I still do that.
This is not a panel about raptor-related media only.
Yes. So.
We only do games where you can beat raptors.
Yeah. Do we have any other questions? Yes.
This is more of a writing-based question, and it comes down to consent with NPCs and how to go about that. There was some talk about BioWare and how they're now using a model of each character has sort of their sexual preference and limiting the player's agency based on that. How do you think the best way to go about that is? I really like the idea of having romantic interests that do not pan out, like avoiding that dating sim of you're able to sleep with anyone you want. Like, how do you give your NPCs their own agency when you're not controlling them? It's a difficult find, I find, of making them relatable characters, but depending on the goal of the game, how negotiating that interaction with the main character. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think, well, for one, especially if you're not in a large company or whatever, like, romance often is kind of seen as a side thing. I mean, they actually come out and say romance is a side thing, right? And I think for, you know, for better games, you're going to want smaller, more focused games. And I think it would be great to have games where you literally are just talking with people, getting to know them, doing whatever, and dating around. And then you can explore that a lot more in depth. Another thing with NPCs, NPCs are literally going to be, like, triggers and rules, which is kind of funny just thinking about those words, they all have triggers, and they can have certain triggers happen at certain times. And, you know, I think you can be creative with the use of triggers and variables and rules. And, you know, because in a sense, when we think about NPCs, like characters, they're representing something to the player. There's something for the player that modifies their experience, that makes a player think about, you know, who they're interacting with, what it says about themselves. So when you have characters, that is the best way to kind of, like, why is this character here? Like, what is this character doing to challenge the player's way of thinking? And then that way you can model that. And if there's going to be a character who you want to consider playing with the idea of consent, you can have certain situations and triggers and things like that to happen where they can explore, like, good and bad things with that. And in the sense, like, here it is, like you know, computer characters are literally computer characters, you know, they're not real. So, but the depiction and why that depiction's there matters. So let's say, you know, that it doesn't mean like all rape cannot be in games, right? You know, that's not the point. The point is when and where is rape and other, you know, things used, and why, and who is deciding those things. So I think if you're extra thoughtful about that process, then you're gonna find, you know, less of an issue. Like right now, when we think about, you know, these games and, you know, are they player sexual or are they, you know, bias? I mean, it's really weird for, you know, to talk about these characters, like, especially when they're like not human, you know, and like they're not human and they have like human sexuality is really weird. I think that's another, you know, a point where it just kind of doesn't make sense. So I think I'm rambling now, but I think you get what I mean, right? Yeah.
So two things I want to add on to that. So I think like I rag on like on Bioware games a lot, but like I played through all three Mass Effect games. So I think they have the potential to be really, really interesting. One thing that I think would be really cool, and like one thing that I think a lot of problems in mainstream games come from is the fact that they're all organized, like Maddie's talked about a lot, around the player character as this like central heroic figure who like grows in power, and the story is basically all about them. And that's not just games, that's like all media to some extent, right? What would be really cool is if instead of playing Shepard for all three Mass Effect games, you switch perspectives around. And I think one thing that that would do is imagine if like you had a conversation or like you've had a few conversations with a potential romantic interest for Shepard, and you're like picking all the right dialogue options, and then you switch to the other person's perspective, and you see like how manipulative like they're coming across, and you're like, right? Oh my God, this is really gross. I don't want to like fuck you, like get away from me. I think that would be so effective. It's like the kind of thing that is unlikely to happen because games are so invested in that model of like heroic journeys, but it would be really cool. The other thing, that would also kind of disrupt this is like I want the Dark Souls of space romance games.
Yes.
Where you can't save scum or you can't go back to like, oh well, I screwed up that time, I'll go back and like say the right thing this time. There's a game that does a really interesting job of playing with that idea. It's called Save the Date.
Yes.
And it plays with this idea of like dating sims of like going back to like pick the right choices, but it incorporates that actually into the game. And I don't want to say too much about it because it's like really fascinating, but it takes like 20 minutes to play and it's free online. So you should definitely look that up if you are interested in that kind of thing.
Yeah, I always used to say like with my question to BioWare games, like when I raise a difficulty, why don't my relationships get harder? Mm-hmm. You know, like, you know, like, it's just like, you know, it's just thinking about that, right? It's just, what does that even look like? Like, what does it mean if I put, you know, relationships on hard? Does that mean I actually have to listen to them or something? I don't know. Like,
yeah, so on the hardest difficulty, you have this, you can have the romantic side quest where you have to woo the person, but you can't be like, too open about the relationship because they're not out at work or out with their guild. And so like, yeah.
They want to try poly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That would be a game in itself.
Tegan.
Advertising in relation to all of this too, in terms of how games are marketed and advertised and how that ties into ideas of coercion, right? Because marketing is like, we want to get you to buy the game,
right?
Right? So we're going to tell you things about what we're going to do that we may not fulfill, and it turns into a little bit of a bait and switch, and that's very much a coercion. I think we see that a lot with bigger game companies that are relying on like, the actual, we have to get money. So we have to advertise this in certain ways to get money. I don't know, I guess that was more of a comment than a question.
I feel like my immediate reaction to that is I was thinking about pinball marketing. So there's the Internet Pinball Database is a really good tool, and part of, they document every pinball machine, and they also document all the promotional materials that come with that. And a lot of pinball machines were marketed with beautiful women, where you would have like a scantily clad woman draped across the pinball machine.
So weird.
Just like it was a fucking car, right? And that's like really strange because that's not you're going to play. Like, you're not going to play the pinball machine at a place where beautiful women will lie on top of it. You're gonna play it in some bar. And actually, like a lot of pinball machines made in the 80s and 90s, actually, once you take them apart, actually have foam surrounding the electronics to pick up beer that is spilled on top of the machine. Like, you know, and so like, I feel like almost to a degree that is like a sort of coercion of like, well, if you play Bally's Wizard, then someone sexy like Anne Margaret is going to drape over it and perhaps you can, you know, tilt her. But no, like, no, you're gonna go to some like, you know, it's gonna be this like beat up, like old machine that hasn't been maintained in some like Canadian grocery store, and you're gonna have to wait in line while like four other tourists are like taking pictures of themselves like, oh look, pinball in Canada. Like, no, yeah, like, I mean, and that's more of a humorous example, and I'm sure that my co-panelists could think of like more, I guess, like contextually appropriate examples.
Well, I think that you can do, like, so here's, like, the wrong way. So if anybody might remember, a couple years ago, a game called Catherine came out, and it was a game that was pitching itself to be about mature relationships, and you can guess that that didn't quite happen. But what is this marketing material literally had, like, body pillows, certain shirts, and I think a pizza box, and a whole bunch of other things, right? And the thing about it is, like, you know, the way that it crafted itself was really, you know, obviously gross, and in a way that the game is for the player to kind of express being gross at. And I can imagine just kind of what they could have done, like, in, like, the other way around. Like, imagine a body pillow that kind of, like, talked to you or something, or was kind of, like, whenever you touched it, like, saying, ask first, please. You know, like, I would love a body pillow that kind of said, like, can you please, I need space. You know, that would be a great thing. So I think there's ways that people could use marketing to not to kind of invite a conversation or invite a new relationship to games. And you know what, I think, we're probably, you know, here on this panel probably talking about more, like, smaller games. You know, I've never marketed anything in my life. So I kind of, when you do present it, is very often I find around current events very often. And it's really interesting when we do have games that come out around current events and talking about those. And that's a really interesting, you know, conversation to have about when these games come out, because like, I could imagine when, you know, we had that, I guess we still do, but when we had a very televised week of shootings in this country, how much, you know, games that came around that time that had to deal with like sex and things like that were really weird, because I do judging for games and things, and I got, you know, I commonly play games about rape and things like that because people see me as good at those games for some reason. It gave the context very different. So I think the as we move on, mostly because I'm quite uninterested in large games and their marketing, that how we as people, when we are making our individual games, what context we release them into and with what events and what is the social, you know, environment for them.
I mean, as somebody who does do marketing, though not for games, for other stuff, like porn.
Other stuff.
I think that one of the things that I notice a lot and actually influences what games I'm going to buy is whether or not the women that they use to advertise the game are actually people you can play, which they often aren't. They often have a little bit part at one moment and then they're gone. And I find that really frustrating. Like for me, as somebody who's not really an avid gamer, but like interested and curious, when over and over again I'm disappointed that I can't actually play the characters that are being used to advertise, they're just props, it feels really invalidating to my existence. So it makes me feel less interested in games. And that really sucks. So I feel like there is definitely responsibility there. And I think that sometimes these things can be really subtle. I would love to see a mainstream game that poses men, like their main muscly, often main characters, in similar ways to how they've posed women in the past, and possibly as scantily dressed. I think that would be really interesting, because it would be a way to disrupt the objectification process. I mean, also, I would totally perv out on it, which, you know, might make me buy their game. So there is this ignorance of the queer gaze or the female gaze when these things are advertised. And I think that that does gaming and society a massive disservice.
I agree that we should have more games for female gays.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I'm sorry. Sorry. I'll leave. I think there was
So I have a bit of a comment coupled with a question. We spoke earlier in the panel about putting the player in a position of aggressor and of doing really uncomfortable things. Game that comes to mind was Heavy Rain. It's an older game, but there's a point where you have to do some really heinous things to other people and yourself. Coupled in with, there is a horror game coming out soon. I apologize, I don't have the title in mind, but it's adaptive to the way that you move and interact with the environment, and the game switches to itself, or like how you move. If you're more timid, things will slow down, etc. It's a reactive game. Do you think that there could be some interesting things done in terms of consent with webcams and some of the littler, less expensive technology, or some of the things that are bundled with bigger systems in terms of player reaction? So even if you choose to do a bad thing, if you get all scrunchy and like you get distress face, do you think that could be something in the future of games to make them more interesting and possibly less icky?
I think it could be used. I'm curious only because, like, I mean, that is intense technology that you're talking about, in the sense of, like, just, like, recognition of faces and things like that. Sure, yes. I think what is possibly more interesting is what are other ways, how can we tell what the player is feeling by their actions? So kind of like how you're doing it, but like even just like, I don't know, like it would be like, I kind of think about making the player do something else. So like maybe there are some games like in order to keep breathing or something, you have to kind of, you know, keep doing that. And it's very easy to kind of notice when someone's doing this because they're panicking or, you know, they're calm and they're trying to breathe. And so I think there's like game mechanics and things that can tie in a more direct thing than that, because I think that would buy in people's reaction. I don't know, because for me, having like a web, you know, doing a webcam and things like that, you know, would add a different layer to where I'm like meta aware of things. And I'm really interested in the idea of what does our body already do when we're playing games to signal those sort of things. But I think that's interesting. It's an interesting question.
Oh, okay. I was going to plug, so there's a comedian, Kumail Nanjiani. He's a stand-up comedian, and he has a bit about Heavy Rain. And he talks about how horrible and, like, distressing the game is. And then he reminds you that he paid $60 to have that experience.
Right.
And I think that's, like, a really interesting, like, I feel like it's really interesting satire, and I implore everyone to check it out. I think we'll do one more question. All right. Kumail Nanjiani.
Hi, I don't know. I'd like to see what you guys think about it. I mean, because I think a game that I've been playing recently that really kind of messes with, messes with consent is Antechamber.
Okay.
Are you guys familiar?
Yes.
And so, I mean, it's not like forcing, you know, people who play to do like heinous things, but I mean, you know, just kind of, it screws with you. It like, you know, moves stuff around. And so I'm just wondering, like, I mean, any thoughts on that? I'm not really sure, like where one would take what you guys have been saying and move it into this space.
So I guess to preface this, Antechamber's been like sitting on my Steam list since like a Steam sale like a year ago or something. So I haven't played it. But I think like one thing that we have to, that's like important for me to do is like, there is this like really insidious argument against the stuff that we've been talking about that's like, oh, what? So like you can't mess with players at all. Like you can't do anything interesting. Like you, it's like, that's absolutely not true. Like the things that you're describing sound like really interesting. And yeah, I don't think anyone on this panel would say like it's not okay for a game to like pull tricks on players and stuff. I guess like, yeah, like the context that it's happening is important and like what we want to be talking about, but like, has anyone actually played Antechamber?
I played a little bit of it. When you said your question, the thing I think about is like the genre of horror games. So horror games intentionally like screw with you, and you know, like in horror movies, you go to them to be fucked with, right? And they actually, which is why it's so interesting for me about how horror has actually, you see a lot of theory and design, like kind of just like really embedded in those genres. And so when I think about horror and just kind of what it does mechanically, I can already see what it does for consent and things like that. Like very forced camera angles, like, you know, not having a free reeling 3D, you know, agency. I think actually the best thing that you can talk about, I think maybe you're possibly touching on, is just how much agency does and control does the player start with. I think what's a really interesting thing when I think about games that are coming out of like, you know, more DIY stuff is how much there's restriction to the player. Like how much the player is restricted, how much they don't have a lot of options of things to do. And it makes their options a lot more meaningful. And so I think when you start from there and you kind of know that the game is going to be having a certain relationship with you as you go in, then you can really, you know, you can mess with them in many ways. I mean, you know, if you, to give the example, you know, to, I guess we keep, you know, rounding back around to BDSM. But I mean, you know, there's lots of mean things that bottoms consensually ask to be fucked with. You know, it's a thing that happens, and they're put into predicaments. They're put into stressing situations, and they do it for a reason. And I think people do that with, like, I mean, like, I think about Dark Souls. Like, who goes to Dark Souls and say, I'm going to have, like, a this joyous, happy time with cupcakes? You know, no, you go because you're going to die constantly over and over and over again, maybe cry a little bit and whatever. So I think what it is that, like, it is this idea, like, we were talking about kind of like a culture of silence, this idea of, like, you know, if we intentionally go to games for very particular reasons, then we can have a really wide range instead of having, like, it being hush, and then having to, you know, try to, like, coddle the player to make sure that they get around in this game. So I think having a very clear, focused intention for what your player, what you want to do with your player, can kind of lend to, you know, that sort of thing.
I would find it really interesting to have a mainstream game, or even not a mainstream game, but I think it would be particularly interesting in a mainstream game, that catalogs your choices and, like, catalogs things like microaggressions or violent behaviors, but doesn't, like, show it to you all the time like it's some sort of award, but rather is just sort of like an accountability thing, like at the end of your game session, sort of just as a way to reflect back to you, like, did you, like, I'm imagining this with, like, Grand Theft Auto, for example, right? Like, would you play it differently if at the end it was like, wow, so you actually killed 20 prostitutes today? And didn't make any judgment on that, didn't give you a perk for it or an award or anything like that, but just reflected that back at you. I wonder if people would play these things differently if those consequences were available.
There's actually, there's a game called Metal Gear Solid 3 where, again, spoilers, but this game's like 10 years old. So at one point, you're forced to wade through a river containing the dead bodies of everyone you've murdered in the game.
Nice.
So there are things that have, like, experimented with that. And then if you haven't killed anyone, then it's, like, totally different. So
I kind of think about, like, you know,
is it easier to get through the river?
I haven't actually played Metal Gear Solid. I'm, like, really bad at video games.
I kind of think about, you know how at the end of, like, RPGs, sometimes you get, like, the montage of, like, here are all the things you had an effect on because you're a cool hero, you know? I can just imagine, like, you know, and there is a build-up to that, right? You know, like, you really do a whole bunch of things, and then you want to see the effects that you had on the world. And I can imagine, you know, being used, you know, in different ways, especially if your games are shorter, whenever you end a play session, no, you have a mini montage of what you're doing or the effects that you're having, and you can easily kind of telegraph that information. So I think that's totally possible, you know, to do.
All right. So we'll have everyone go through and, like, last plugs, like, if anyone wants to, like, you know, your blog or Twitter. Before we do that, I want to thank GamerX for hosting us. I want to thank the really rad sound people in the back. They've been really, really accommodating and really classy, and all of you for coming. So I can be found at doublecakes.biz, and on Twitter I am Jetta_RAE.
You can, my site is my name, MaddieBryce.com. That's my Twitter handle, except there's an X in the front of it because I'm not very creative. And I also have a Patreon. So if you're interested in my work, any of my writing, go ahead and see if you can support. And I also, on my website, have a list of people who are doing interesting writing in games who have funding pages. So if you're interested in more thoughts and themes that are, you know, kind of that come from this panel, and you want to see more intelligent writing on games, check it out and see if you can support people.
Jetta also has a Patreon. I'm gonna put that
out. Thank you.
And so do I.
You're gonna notice a running Patreon thread.
I think I'm actually funding everyone on this panel. So yeah, I'm found at Kitty Stryker on Twitter, and that's Stryker with a Y, Kitty also with a Y, and my website's kittystryker.com. I blog about a lot of different things. Don't Google me unless you're not at work. So, yeah.
Yeah, my Twitter is M_KOPAS, and my website is mkopas.net. I'm writing a chapter on sex and games for a book being put out by Seven Stories, so keep an eye out for that. I don't know what the title is yet. And I'm also doing I think this is the first time I've ever talked about this, a Twine anthology that's going to be coming out next year. So also keep an eye out for that.
Thank you all. You've been a great crowd.
Thank you.